In terms of global obsession, this next game broke all the records. It was one of those classic, why didn't I think of that ideas? A game so simple no one in the world could resist playing. It was called Tetris. And next to cocaine, it was the most addictive substance being passed around in the party-hardy 1980s. And the idea came right out of Party Central. Well, make that communist Party Central. In 1984, Alexei Pajitnov was working at the Academy of Science in Moscow. Occupation? Mathematician. His hobby? Puzzles. Alexei came up with Tetris using his computer at work. He based it on an old Russian puzzle game called Pentomino.
So this is original Pentomino, which I brought from Russia. And I had an idea to make two-player game with this. And I start to program it. And when I program it, I see, well, in order to put it there, you need to flip it or rotate it. That was the moment when Tetris was born.
In 1985, the game was ready, and Alexei made his big launch, Soviet style.
Release in Russian means that you give the copy to your friends. And that was like a forest of fire, you know. In 2 weeks, it was on every single PC in Moscow, and probably in Russia, I don't know.
And of course, Alexei made a ton of money, retired, and he's been sitting around sipping Stoli in his 30-room mansion ever since. Yeah, right. This was the Soviet Union, remember?
It was the communist power in Russia. So basically, at that point, we are agreed that I will grant them all my rights for 10 years.
So the communists did what any good capitalist would do. They sold the rights to Tetris around the world. It started showing up on US computers in January of 1988. Soon everyone was playing, at home, at work, on company time, personal time. It didn't seem to matter. The nation was transfixed. Kids, ask your parents. If they say they never played Tetris, they're lying.
Tetris is very intuitive. Kids are very good in Tetris. Adult people, even senior people, like these games. Everybody finds something for himself with this game.
Smelling a hit, Nintendo used Tetris to launch Game Boy, their new handheld gaming device.
The very big part of the Tetris success is connected to Game Boy. Somehow this platform and this game was born for each other. Game Boy with Tetris was sold in the number of 30 million. It's a pretty big number.
Not only was the game a hit, it helped establish the Game Boy as a viable and popular gaming platform that could move software in numbers that rivaled consoles and PCs, and continues to do that kind of business today. The best part of the story? In 1996, Tetris rights returned to Alexei. Now instead of Stoli, he's sipping Starbucks in Seattle, where he works with Microsoft. And new generations are discovering Tetris on a variety of platforms, including mobile phones.
We collect and distribute royalties for the game. They are not that big anymore, but it's still good.
As the 1990s kicked in, Nintendo was riding high. Not only was the Game Boy doing great, but Nintendo had single-handedly rebuilt the home console market, leaving Atari and the toy makers in the dust. The NES was the leader of the pack with their lock on hit titles and game franchises. Sega was also hanging in there with their Master System. They decided it was time to challenge Nintendo's supremacy, and in 1989, Sega launched the Genesis console.
When the Sega Genesis came out, it really brought video games to the next generation of technical capabilities.
Our agency created the slogan, Genesis does what Nintendo don't, which meant we have a 16-bit system, they have an 8-bit system. It was the first competitive position in the video game industry in terms of home game systems.
In the no-holds-barred campaign, Sega rolled out their secret weapon, a blue hedgehog called Sonic.
They said, you know what, this is going to be our mascot. He's going to have more of an attitude. He's going to be geared toward a slightly older audience, and he's going to be fast. they used to show Sonic just like whizzing by on the screen and just going super fast while Mario's just kind of jumping up and down. And they really made Mario out to be some kid's character. While Sonic was, hey, this is the next hottest thing.
And this sound, heard at the end of every Sega commercial, piled on the attitude. While Sega and Nintendo were fighting over the home market, gamers were heading back to the arcades, where the games were more graphic and intense. Games like Street Fighter II and Mortal Kombat.
Mortal Kombat is a game where after you've beaten your opponent, you can put in what's called a fatality, and you can rip out their spine and their skull, or stick your hand into their chest and pull out their heart, or a whole bunch of other really grisly little endings.
Both Sega and Nintendo wanted to match the visual quality of these intense arcade games. Sega saw possibilities in a new format, the CD-ROM. One CD could hold 320 times more data than a console cartridge. To you and me, that's just more gaming power. But just as Sega began to consider the CD-ROM, personal computers beat them to the punch. In 1993, a new game designed for the Macintosh home computer made its debut.
Blue Pages.
It was designed by Rand and Robin Miller, two brothers who had found modest success designing children's computer games. Working out of their garage in Spokane, Washington, they crafted an immersive, interactive world. Myst.
Typically, games start with a gameplay system. Ours start with a place. In our minds, we were building real places that people could lose themselves in. They'd sit down in front of their computer, they'd turn the lights down, turn the sound up, and they'd forget that they were in this world, and they would feel like they were in that world. The graphics in Myst were what defined it, because for the first time, I think people saw stuff on their screen that could be mistaken for real images or real places. There were some terrific constraints, like we couldn't actually move the pictures in real time. So we built them very realistic, but they were still.
Myst was the killer app for CD because it allowed for this incredible wealth of graphics that we had really never seen before. Floppy disk just couldn't handle the size of these graphics.
Myst became the must-have game, selling 250,000 copies in 12 months. It stayed on computer game bestseller lists for the next 3 years, selling over 4 million copies. It also turned the Miller brothers into millionaires.
I smile because I look back and think, well, we were two stupid brothers sitting in the garage. We didn't have great insight. We maybe had some good instincts, and the timing was right.
For loads of gamers, Myst was a watershed moment, with its enchanting, magical graphics helping to create a completely immersive experience. But the next killer application for multimedia PC would follow arcade games down a much darker, more brutal road. And suddenly, the video game industry would find itself in a head-on collision with the U.S. government.